On June the 21st, 1919, in the dark, calm waters of Scarpa Flow in the Orkneys, the Grand Fleet of the Imperial German Navy, interned by the British after World War I, scuttled its ships in one last act of defiance towards its captors. In a few brief moments, German sea power literally disappeared from the face of the earth. Yet only 20 years later, the naval forces of the Third Reich would again challenge British supremacy of the oceans. Once again, the U-boats would be at the cutting edge of the battle. This is one of the last surviving U-boats in the world. Standing peacefully in a quiet corner of Birkenhead Docks, Liverpool, U-534 presents a sorry, melancholy spectacle, a ghost of the menacing craft which once hunted with the deadly wolf packs. We can still clearly see the marks left by the impact of the depth charges which sank her. Beneath the rusting exterior lurks the lean profile of the predator. Very faintly, we can still sense a few echoes of the glory days. We can imagine the torpedoes primed for action, the noise of the crew assembling at battle stations, and suddenly the years roll back to 1939, when the U-boats stood on the brink of their greatest challenge. On the eve of World War II, Germany's Kriegsmarine prepared to join battle with its implacable enemy, the Royal Navy. For over a decade, the German Navy had been rebuilding in secret. Once Adolf Hitler was safely settled into power, all pretense was cast aside. A new grand fleet of revolutionary warships emerged from the slipways of German docks. Their names became bywords throughout the world. The Scharnhorst, the Prince Eugen, and the Bismarck. The new Kriegsmarine presented an impressive order of battle. Its officers were of the highest quality. Many had served in the old Imperial Navy. As a breed, they frowned upon the excesses of Nazi fanaticism. But some of their own harsh naval traditions were no less extreme. Nonetheless, this was a war which would be fought on ruthless terms, and these were the men for just such a task. Despite the impressive start he'd made to the Navy, Hitler's military preoccupation was primarily with land forces, and his conquests were made by a series of rapid campaigns fought at lightning speed through continental Europe. In this grand strategy, Hitler had envisaged a very limited role for the Navy. It was their job to guard Germany against any threat from the sea. Of course, national pride demanded a modern German fleet. But it was not part of Hitler's plans to enter into a serious naval rivalry with the might of Great Britain. On September the 1st, 1939, as Hitler invaded Poland, the entry of the German Navy into the war was signaled not by the guns of the Grand Fleet, but by those of a lone training ship. With her ancient armament, she opened fire on the fortress. For the Kriegsmarine, war had begun. Once again, they had to contend with the prospect of powerful Allied navies. The war had come several years too early for the German Navy. In the latter years of the 1930s, Germany had embarked upon an ambitious construction program for 200 U-boats. But by the time war broke out, fewer than 50 were operational. Grand Admiral Erich Raeder's message to the fleet commanders, ordering them to take up battle stations, ended on a note of finality. Gentlemen, we have no choice. Total engagement, die with dignity. Although her ships were superbly engineered and very modern in design, the Kriegsmarine was still highly outnumbered by the Royal Navy. Fleet-to-fleet conflict was therefore unthinkable. But when they could choose the place and time, the German Navy was able to operate remarkably effectively. At the cutting edge of those operations were the U-boats. The U-boats which were at sea were divided into three main categories. The small Type 2 class was used for coastal patrol and mine laying, the Type 7 for medium endurance operations, and the double-hulled Type 9 for oceanic warfare. Fittingly, this crumbling survivor of the U-boat fleets was an ocean-going craft. She was actually on her way to Argentina and safety when she was sunk on the second to last day of the war. When U-534 settled onto the muddy floor of the Baltic, the open hatchways through which her crew had escaped rapidly allowed the silt of the seabed to fill the submarine. In this way, the treasures of World War II were preserved, as if in aspic. Pencil notes on logbooks can still be read. Discarded uniforms, gramophone records, books, food stocks, and even an old ship's broom are still there, as if it were yesterday. Most eerily of all, when she was raised to the surface, the Kriegsmarine flag still hung limply from her masthead. Fortunately for U-534, she was hit while still on the surface. A depth charge, which had lodged next to the conning tower, exploded on being rolled into the sea, rendering the ship unsubmersible. A second depth charge blew in the side of the craft. All of her crew managed to escape the sinking. Even the five crew members trapped in the hull survived. As she sank to the bottom and settled in the shallow depths, they escaped through the torpedo tubes. Although three crewmen later died of exposure, U-534 was not a war grave, so she could be salvaged, and we are spared the awful resonances from hundreds of other U-boat sinkings, where the steel hull is also a coffin for her crew. There is a sense of justice in the fact that the sinking of the U-boat should rank among the very last acts of that titanic conflict, because on the first day of the war, it was a U-boat that torpedoed and sank the passenger liner Athenia in flagrant breach of international law. The leader of the U-boat fleet was Admiral Karl Dönitz, a submarine veteran of the Great War. Under him, the U-boat fleet enjoyed immediate and startling success in the Atlantic and the North Sea. They knew from experience that the coming campaign would be brutal and savage. There was no room for sentimentality. This was to be a dirty, nasty, and devious fight to the death. The first casualty was to be human decency. In a taste of what was to come, survivors from stricken merchant ships were machine-gunned as they struggled to life rafts. Although it was not habitual, acts like this certainly took place on more than one occasion. The sudden onset of war had left the giant merchant fleets of Britain scattered across the oceans of the world. As the unescorted and defenseless ships dashed frantically for safe havens, they fell easy prey to the U-boats and the auxiliary cruisers. Throughout the winter months, there was massive destruction of Allied shipping. This destruction took place frequently on the surface. The U-boat would sink the unarmed ships by fire from its deck gun. Although this was a dangerous maneuver, there was often no choice. German torpedoes were plagued by development problems, which caused many to fail to explode. In early 1939, hurried arrangements were implemented for British merchant ships to travel in tight, escorted convoys, which allowed the unarmed ships to be guided by destroyers and cruisers. In these early days, the system was clumsy, and the speed of the convoy was that of the slowest ship, but it significantly increased the chances of survival overall. In that first year of the war, to travel alone constituted instant death from beneath the waves. Despite the losses from the First World War, the Royal Navy was caught ill-prepared for the new submarine menace. The vast seaways provided ample scope for an elusive U-boat. The chances of discovering a U-boat were minimal, and the British warships themselves were not immune from danger. On September the 17th, the aircraft carrier Courageous was sunk with the loss of over 500 men. It was a major loss to the Royal Navy. In a daring solo run, U-boat 47, under the command of Lieutenant Prine, under cover of darkness, found a passage into Scarpa Flow and sank the Royal Oak. The stricken battleship settled amidst the wreckage of the old German Imperial fleet. 833 British seamen died, whilst the U-47 escaped unscathed. Lieutenant Prine and his crew returned to a hero's welcome in Germany. Enthusiasm reached new heights when it was revealed that Dönitz himself had masterminded the raid. He'd gained experience of the harbor during his time as a captive with the German fleet after the First World War. Dönitz's personal role in the raid was widely publicized, and he played it to full advantage. Dönitz was rewarded with promotion, and he used his new celebrity status to extract a promise from Hitler to build many more of the vital U-boats. This early success meant that the full fury of submarine warfare would soon be unleashed against the British merchant marine. The German war at sea was dominated by two commanders, Admiral Raeder, the architect of the Kriegsmarine, who was a fine strategist, and his subordinate Dönitz, who was an outstanding fleet commander. Both were products of the Imperial German Navy. This was a class instilled with a deep sense of duty and obedience to the state. Neither condoned Hitler's regime, and both contrived to avoid the politics and intrigue of Berlin. The two men agreed that the key to victory over Britain lay in cutting supply lines, but they could not agree as to how best this might be achieved. Dönitz strongly advocated the submarine weapon, whereas Raeder favored the grand battle fleet. The stalemate was about to be decided by events.
Klar bei Torpedos!
The pocket battleship Graf Spee, at large in the Indian Ocean, had sunk nine ships by December of 1939. When she was sighted by three British cruisers. The engagement left the ship badly damaged, and she took refuge for the maximum of 4 days in neutral Montevideo harbor. Mistakenly believing that his ship faced certain destruction by a superior British force, her captain sailed the Graf Spee to the harbor mouth and ordered the magazines to be blown. On learning of his error, he shot himself. For Hitler and his high command, it was a humiliating debacle under the full gaze of the world. The success of the U-boats, compared to the humiliation suffered by the Graf Spee, swung the tide of opinion behind Dönitz and his U-boats. For the Kriegsmarine, the main burden of the surface fight at sea was now carried by the smaller craft, destroyers, torpedo boats, and mine layers. In the early months of the war, the most successful weapon employed by the surface fleet was the mine. Of these, the most effectual and the most feared was the magnetic mine. Unnoticed by British observers, German destroyers clandestinely completed 11 mine-laying missions off the English coast, even venturing into the Thames estuary itself. The mines wreaked havoc amongst the Channel traffic. 67 ships, including two destroyers, were lost. These losses, added to the steadily rising toll taken by the U-boats, clearly showed the way ahead. The U-boats had won the political war. But could they also be relied upon to win the real war? It seemed Hitler needed one more lesson to convince him. In April 1940, Hitler launched a preemptive strike against Norway. He was relying on a combination of air and sea power. This was the only major amphibious operation the Germans would undertake during World War II. The Kriegsmarine committed the greater part of its surface fleet, and the U-boat fleet was recalled from the Atlantic to provide protection. The Allies knew nothing of German intentions, and it was only a chance sighting that led to the first naval engagement, in which the German cruiser Hipper was left severely damaged. The Norwegian shore batteries took a bruising toll of the German shipping. And from out to sea, the Royal Navy, too, was closing in. Although the U-boat fleet attacked 20 British warships, not one of the action succeeded, as the torpedoes which struck had failed to detonate. A solution would soon be found, but not soon enough to prevent a humiliating setback for Dönitz and the Kriegsmarine. In the battle which followed, the cost to the German surface fleet was considerable. The heavy cruiser Blücher and the Hipper were crippled, and 13 destroyers were lost. The Kriegsmarine's operational surface fleet was reduced to one heavy cruiser, two light cruisers, and four destroyers. Hitler consoled his adjutants with the less than convincing sentiment that if the German Navy were to do nothing else in the war, it had amply justified its existence by its contribution to the Norwegian campaign. Ironically, his words were to prove highly prophetic. From now on, the only real impact on the war at sea would be made by the U-boats. The U-boat's role was increasingly vital to the war at sea. The acquisition of French and Norwegian coasts increased the westward range of the U-boats, and in the 5 months to October 1940, 274 merchant ships were sunk for the loss of only six U-boats. For Britain, such loss rates were unsustainable. There was a real possibility that Britain could be starved into submission. A concerted submarine offensive mounted at this stage of the war could have proved decisive. Yet, despite Dönitz's pleas, he was denied the resources to exploit this golden opportunity. In 1939, the first year of the war, 28 new U-boats were built. But these were exactly enough to replace those which had been lost. Hitler had reneged on his earlier promise. Amongst the intriguers and power brokers of the Nazi hierarchy, the Kriegsmarine was poorly represented and came a poor third to the army and the Luftwaffe in the allocation of resources. Not only was the Nazi system corrupt, it was also inefficient. As a result, Germany continued with the construction of a prestigious but largely useless Grand Fleet at the expense of the U-boat fleet. Since Goering insisted on keeping all air power as his personal fiefdom, a naval air arm could not be developed. In the war at sea, close cooperation between air and sea forces was paramount, but no German aircraft carrier was ever launched. For the whole of 1939 and into 1940, the U-boats operated blind. It was not until the late summer of 1940 that the Kriegsmarine received effective air power in the form of a limited quantity of long-range Fokker-Wulf Condors. Working directly with the U-boats, these reconnaissance aircraft immediately proved their worth. In the first 2 months of operations, 30 Allied ships were sunk. Despite their limited resources, by the autumn of 1940, Dönitz and his captains had perfected new tactics. Chief among these was the evolution of the Wolf Pack. It was an efficient mode of attack against the Atlantic convoys, which were still only lightly escorted. The huge Atlantic sea lanes were patrolled by dispersed groups of U-boats, each operating independently. When an individual boat sighted a convoy, the position was signaled to base control. Expertly coordinated by Dönitz and his staff, the other U-boats rapidly gathered together to converge on the prey, shadowing the convoy by day and attacking by night. There were several reasons for preferring the night attack. While it was submerged, a U-boat traveled very slowly. 8 knots was the maximum practical speed, and the duration of the dive was strictly limited. On the surface, a U-boat could maintain 16 knots, giving the boats a hugely increased range. In the early stages of the war, the convoy still relied mainly on visual observation to detect submarines. In the dark, the low profile of a U-boat was easily missed. The U-boat's much larger targets were clearly silhouetted against the sky, particularly if another vessel had been set alight. As they gained experience in their deadly trade, the Wolf Packs became bolder, and some adventurous captains even took to striking within the convoy itself, where the escorts dared not use their guns for fear of hitting their own ships. For the merchant seamen working on the convoys, their working world had become a nightmare. They had to endure weeks of tension, anxiously waiting in their noisy, uncomfortable ships, hoping against hope that this time it was not their turn. If a torpedo struck, there was little chance of survival. No other ship would dare come to their rescue, as they too would almost certainly fall victim to the prowling U-boat. In the early years of the war, the British had two devices for detecting submarines. The first was the hydrophone, a simple listening device which could detect propeller noise. It could be defeated by the submarine shutting down its engine, and it could only be used if the ship also stopped its own propellers. Much more was expected of the ASDIC, a device which emitted high-frequency sound and detected the reflections from the submarine. The searching vessel could continue at full speed and could determine the submarine's position and course. Infuriatingly, the early ASDIC sets lost the signal when they were immediately over the submarine, making the accurate placing of the depth charges difficult. Additionally, the U-boat crew, alerted by the distinctive ping of the Azdic, would often alter course and slip away. During the early phase of the war, known to their crews as the Happy Time, the most successful U-boat commanders acquired celebrity status, akin to that of the Luftwaffe's fighter aces. The public adulation was hard-earned. The submariners were a breed apart. This is the interior of HMS Onyx, a British submarine built in the 1950s. But the claustrophobic interior layout was not dissimilar to the cramped world of the U-boat crews, who shared their dangers with a fierce sense of pride and companionship. Describing life on a U-boat, one captain said, "It is my job as a submarine commander to sink ships. To do this, I need a cooperative crew so that everything clicks. Life aboard is monotonous for long stretches. For many long periods, one must be able to bear failures. And when depth charges are added, life becomes a war of nerves. Life aboard a submarine is unnatural and unhealthy. There is no change between night and day, and the lights have to burn all the time. There is no regular time for sleeping, as most fighting is done at night. In a submarine, there is no margin for error. You are either alive or dead." Amongst the enemy, the U-boats aroused fear and loathing. Their mode of warfare was utterly ruthless, cunning, and impersonal. Despite this, a U-boat crew was an assortment of very human individuals, living and fighting under exceptionally harsh conditions. They remained in their uncomfortable, claustrophobic vessels for perhaps months at a time, rarely seeing daylight. Lack of water meant men sported beards, and they lived in a cramped, malodorous world of sweat, oil, noise, and heat. In addition to the unforgiving seas, they knew if their craft were hit, there was little chance of escape. When pursued by a destroyer, they must all endure that fear known only to the U-boat crew. They huddled silently together, tensely listening to the throb of engines overhead. They knew that one well-placed depth charge would turn their underwater home into a steel grave. A damaged hull would be marked by a torrent of water, which would rapidly engulf the craft, taking it to the bottom. If the craft were merely damaged so that control was lost, the hapless crew could do nothing but wait until it sank to the depth at which the hull imploded. The worst nightmare was to be trapped alive on the floor of the ocean with the slow prospect of death by asphyxiation. Despite the dangers, the U-boat pack still enjoyed success. And as the magnitude of shipping losses sharply increased in late 1940, the British raced to develop a counter to Dönitz's wolf packs. To the U-boat sailors, this period of easy victories was still the happy time. By comparison with the submarines, the performance of the main German surface fleet remained very poor, fearful of a repetition of the humiliation which befell the Graf Spee. Hitler had ordered his ships to avoid confrontation with any but inferior forces. But Hitler's instructions could not always be followed. In May 1941, the new battleship Bismarck, accompanied by the heavy cruiser Prince Eugen, were engaged by a British naval force southwest of Iceland. The Germans fought back fiercely, destroying the British battlecruiser Hood and crippling the battleship Prince of Wales. But the Bismarck herself had been hit, and in the continuing fighting suffered further damage from an airstrike launched from the Ark Royal. There was no escaping the guns and torpedoes of the converging home fleet. Hitler's most powerful battleship finally sank on the morning of May the 27th. With it went any last thoughts of fighting a surface campaign. The U-boat remained the Kriegsmarine's best weapon, but its dominance too would soon be challenged. In 1941, the end of the German invasion threat allowed extra British destroyers to be released for convoy duty. Every additional warship was desperately needed. As the numbers grew, the escorts also developed better tactical methods, aided by the rapid improvements in wireless communications. Ironically, the cohesiveness which made the Wolfpack so successful was also the Achilles' heel which rendered them vulnerable. When it became necessary for dispersed U-boats to gather together to form a wolf pack, regular wireless contact with base was inevitable. A new British apparatus, the high-frequency direction finder HFDF, or HFDF, allowed escort ships accurately to locate a U-boat from its frequent radio signals. HFDF was a success, but also introduced in 1941 was another device that changed the whole pattern of the war at sea. During the course of 1941, radar scanners began to sprout from the mastheads of British destroyers. The newly perfected radar would prove decisive in the long-fought battle of the Atlantic. The Germans too had radar technology, but under the Nazi regime, its potential had not been realized. Research was erratic. Their first countermeasure to the new detection system was the totally ineffectual ploy of maintaining radio silence. Radar allowed the fast destroyers to provide protective cover to a convoy even when out of sight. The range over which they could seek out the enemy was also extended. The happy time was over. An early victim of the Allied supremacy was the famous U-boat ace Prime. The Kriegsmarine was facing the prospect of defeat in the Atlantic. However, the supply of new U-boats was improving rapidly, and Dönitz also deployed a number of submarines released from duties in the Channel. The moment of decision in the U-boat war was now imminent. June 1941 saw one of the war's most momentous turning points, Hitler's ill-fated invasion of the Soviet Union. The hazardous Allied convoy route along the North Atlantic to Murmansk and Archangel would soon become a new hunting ground for the U-boats. By late June 1941, the first U-boats appeared in Arctic waters, the most dangerous and inhospitable seas in the world. They preyed on the Allied convoys carrying supplies for the Soviet war effort. For the sailors of both sides, conditions in the Arctic were appalling, a numbing, unending nightmare of fog, ice, and blizzards. Although the threat of enemy action was the constant fear in a seaman's mind, he could equally succumb to exposure, frostbite, or drowning in ferocious storms. Of the 81 vessels sunk on the Arctic convoy routes during 1941, the U-boat fleet accounted for all but three. 38 U-boats were lost with all hands, in the same unforgiving waters. In September 1941, U-boats were ordered to the Mediterranean, where the British were endeavouring to supply the garrison at Malta from their Egyptian bases and through the Gibraltar Straits. Despite their large and modern fleet, the Italians had suffered a string of naval reverses, and Hitler was wearily obliged to come to the assistance of his inept and troublesome ally. At the same time, the British were exacting heavy losses on the Italian convoys, supplying the Axis armies in North Africa to the extent that the entire Africa Corps was in jeopardy. To move the wolf packs away from the Atlantic at such a crucial stage was undoubtedly a grave strategic blunder, though not entirely without compensation. In their new sphere of action, the U-boats not only claimed valuable supply shipping, but also sank three destroyers and the carrier Ark Royal. The price, however, was high. Seven U-boats, with their battle-seasoned crews, were lost. Although the submarine arm was growing in size, so too were its commitments. By the end of 1941, the U-boats were attempting to patrol three entirely separate operational zones: the Mediterranean, the Atlantic, and the Arctic. In December 1941, the Japanese attacked the US base at Pearl Harbor. And days later, Hitler declared war on the United States. Up to this time, the Kriegsmarine had respected America's neutrality and its coastal security zone. Dönitz now launched an immediate all-out attack on American merchant shipping. He only had five U-boats available, but he used this slender force to lethal effect. The US command had learned little from British experiences and was slow to organize convoy protection. The eastern seaboard became a rich killing ground for the U-boats. Off the coast of America, nearly 500 ships were sunk in the first 6 months of 1942. The prospect of a second happy time loomed for the U-boats. But once again, the pendulum would swing against them. In mid-1942, the British perfected a compact airborne radar system which could detect a surfaced submarine from several miles distance. The unprepared U-boat commander could now expect to be surprised by Allied aircraft dropping out of the clouds and flying straight at them on a bombing run. U-boat losses mounted swiftly. Fortunately for the Germans, the aircraft radar was rapidly countered with the Biscay Cross, a simple radar warning device which, from August 1942, gave the submarines just enough warning of an approaching aircraft for them to crash dive to safety. The pendulum had swung back tentatively in favor of the U-boats, and by October, the air sweeps were again ineffective. Once again, Allied shipping losses spiraled, and in March 1943 alone, 627,000 tons were lost. With both Britain and America at war with Germany, the air gap, that portion of the Atlantic out of reach to Allied aircraft, was substantially reduced. With new, better types of aircraft, the air gap continued to close. The vast industrial resources of the US soon began to produce the much-needed carriers and radar-equipped aircraft. Increasingly, the wolf packs were supplied, rearmed, and even repaired at sea. It was a dangerous operation, even in calm weather, and without the prospect of enemy attack. So great was the Allied domination of the oceans that the supply ships themselves were usually specially adapted submarines. By 1943, with the arrival of larger craft, U-boats sailing from Japanese-controlled Indonesia penetrated the Indian Ocean and the waters down to South Africa. But these forays were little more than a token gesture to Hitler's Japanese allies. The Kriegsmarine's war remained centered on Europe and the Atlantic. By this time, the British and American strategic bombing offensive was wreaking daily destruction on German cities. The Kriegsmarine could not remain immune when the bases at Hamburg were devastated. Furthermore, the demands of the Russian front constituted a huge drain on all available manpower and war production. From this point onwards, the fighting capabilities of the German Navy were steadily eroded. For Hitler, 1943 opened with the disastrous loss of the Sixth Army at Stalingrad. Everywhere, the German forces were in retreat. In January, Raeder was driven to resign. He had been increasingly frustrated at the stream of contradictory orders and impossible demands continually issued by the Reich Chancellery. Dönitz, now Grand Admiral, proved more assertive than his predecessor. He was, of course, still a champion of the U-boat fleet. In him, the Wolf Packs had at last gained a determined voice in the councils of war. But it was too late. Inexorably, the balance was tipping against the Kriegsmarine in the Atlantic. The rate of Allied shipbuilding was climbing far above losses. In the first 3 months of 1940, when on average 14 U-boats were on patrol, over 800,000 tons of Allied shipping had been sunk. In a similar period in 1943, with 115 boats operating, the tally was only 550,000 tons. 100 more U-boats were sinking only some three-quarters of the tonnage. More significantly, U-boat losses were growing at an alarming rate. The conventional submarines, which had fared so well in the first winter of the war, were now highly vulnerable to the Allied hunter-killer groups. It became rare for a U-boat to survive more than two sorties. This awful statistic meant that it was impossible to produce experienced crews, and many new submarines were put to sea commanded by just one officer in his 20s with less than the full crew. Very often, both the ship and its young crew were lost on their first voyage. The commander of U-534 was just 26 when his ship was sunk by depth charges from an RAF Liberator. Fortunately for Capitan Lieutenant Nollau and his crew, they were hit while still on the surface, and all 53 hands got out alive. Theirs was a rare escape. On all fronts, the Allies were winning the electronic surveillance war. By March 1943, the air cover gap was bridged, which meant that no part of the Atlantic was out of range of aircraft from Britain or America. British Wellingtons and American Liberators fitted with long-range tanks meant that there was no safe haven for U-boats to surface and recharge their batteries. A chance capture of the secret German Enigma codebook from a crippled U-boat was to have disastrous consequences. All signals to U-boats were coded and could only be decoded on the Enigma codebook. For months, the German commanders were unaware that their codes had been broken. Once again, losses rose dramatically. In the single month of May 1943, over 40 U-boats were destroyed. Dönitz was finally forced to order the withdrawal of the U-boat fleet from the North Atlantic. The Germans had lost the battle, and with it all chance of strangling the fortress island of Britain. With the U-boat fleet under intolerable pressure, the German surface fleet was by now largely impotent. The Scharnhorst made one last sortie before being engaged and sunk in a skillful night action. And almost a year later, the last chapter in the demise of Germany's Grand Fleet was written. The Tirpitz, which Hitler himself had launched 5 years previously, was bombed at anchor and went down with 1,000 of her crew. She had been nearly 3 years in Norwegian waters, during which time she'd attracted 17 major attacks. Yet her huge armaments had never once been used against enemy shipping. Technological improvements were sought on the German side, but it was always too little, too late. In 1944, the snorkel device was introduced, which, by feeding air to the engines, enabled U-boats to run submerged for longer periods. This reduced the dangers of air attack, but speed and flexibility were lost, and in rough seas, the crews had to contend with choking and toxic fumes. When the Allies sent their vast D-Day invasion fleet across the Channel in June 1944, the U-boat struck one last defiant blow. Forty-five submarines were amassed to strike the Allied fleet. 30 were lost. Nonetheless, 56,000 tons of Allied shipping were destroyed. As if it were a real consolation, the German propaganda ministry calculated that to inflict comparable losses by bombing, 9,000 aircraft sorties would have been required. The Pyrrhic victory, if it could be called that, was to be their last success. But to the last hour of the last day of the war, the U-boats continued to fulfill their duties. U-534 is a rarity. She survived from 1942 right through to the second last day of the war. Even then, her young captain and his crew rode the luck, surviving the sinking to be rescued by one of the few remaining German surface ships. In the early months of 1945, as armies battered Germany from east and west, the war in Europe came to its inevitable close. Nollau and his crew slipped out of harbour on a mission to escape for Argentina and safety. They were caught by the ever-present Allied Air Force and sunk by two depth charges. Like U-534, Hitler's grand designs died with him in the Chancellery bunker. He was replaced as head of state by, of all people, Admiral Dönitz. And fittingly, it was Dönitz who issued the order for the U-boats to cease hostilities. My U-boat men, 6 years of warfare lies behind us. You have fought like lions against a crushingly superior force. But unbroken in your warlike courage, you are laying down your arms after an heroic fight which knows no equal. In reverence, we think of our comrades who have died. Comrades, maintain your U-boat spirit with which you fought most bravely and unflinchingly during the long years. It was a poignant valediction to a brave and dedicated fighting force. Of a total of 39,000 men, 5,000 had been captured and 28,000 killed in action. Churchill wrote of the U-boats, "They were the only thing that really frightened me." Man's fear of hidden and deadly perils and of a predator that stalked its prey has reserved for the U-boat a well-deserved reputation. The U-boat was Germany's most sinister and ruthless weapon of destruction.